if you want to. Yeah.
Yes, I hope you have the patience to hear a bit of the chapter of Rajan Priyadarshi, who was the ex-ATS chief. I ask him a question. This is how the question starts. Sir, your CM Narendra Modi is very popular here in Gujarat. Answer, yes, he fools everybody and people get fooled. Question, in that case, as additional DG, would you have had a tough, you would have had a tough time working under them? Answer, they never had the guts to force me to do anything illegal. Question, lawlessness is rampant here, no? Hardly any officers who are upright. Answer, there are a few of them. This man, Narendra Modi, has been responsible for the killing of Muslims across the state. Question, acha, I hear that the cops also towed the line of the government. Answer, all of them, like this PC Pandey, it all happened in their presence. Question, most of the officers say that they have been implicated wrongly. Answer, what wrongly? They have done it, which is why they are now going behind bars. They killed a young girl in an encounter. Question, really? Answer, huh, they called her Lashkar terrorist. She was from Mumra. The story created was she was a terrorist who had come to Gujarat to kill Narendra Modi. Question, and it is false? Answer, yes, it is false. Question, and ever since I got here, everybody's talking about this Sohrabuddin encounter. Mind you, I'm this naive, naive Methali Tyagi. This is how my line of questioning has to be. Answer, the entire country is talking about that encounter. They bummed off that Sohrabuddin and Tulsi Prajapati at the behest of the minister. This minister, Amit Shah, he never used to believe in human rights. He used to tell us that I don't believe in this human rights commissions. And now look at this. The courts have given him bail too. Question, so you never served under him? Answer, of course I did when I was the ATS chief. He transferred Vanzara and brought me in. And I'm a person who believes in human rights. So this Shah calls me to his bungalow. Now, I have never gone to anyone's bungalow, nor anybody's residence or office. So I told him, sir, I haven't seen your bungalow. And he was baffled and asked, why haven't you seen my bungalow yet? Then he said, okay, I'll send you my private vehicle. Come in that. So I said, okay, you send me your vehicle. So when I reach, he says, acha, aapne ek bande ko arrest kiya hai na, jo aapka abhi aaya hai ATS mein, usko maar dalne ka hai. I didn't react. And then he said, dekho, maar dalo, aise aadmi ko jeene ka koi hak nahi hai. So I immediately came to my office and called a meeting of my juniors. I feared that Amit Shah would give them direct orders and get him killed. So I told them, see, I've been given orders to kill him, but nobody is going to touch him. Just interrogate him. I've been told I am not doing it, so you're also not doing it. Question, that was some bravado, sir. Answer, this Narendra Modi called me the day I was retiring and then he said, so what are you planning to do now? And all those kind of questions. So I told him how I was stifled. Then he said, अच्छा ये बताओ सरकार के खिलाफ यहाँ कौन कौन लोग हैं मतलब कितने अफसर सरकार के खिलाफ हैं देन आई आस्क देन ऑफ कोर्स ही आस्क्स मोदी एम आई अलाउड टू आस्क यू समथिंग सो ही सेड आस्क आई आस्क इन द लास्ट टू डेकेड आई हैव सर्वड इन वेरियस कैपेसिटीज डिड यू हियर ऑफ एनीथिंग अगेंस्ट मी ही रिप्लाइड सेइंग आई हैड बीन डूइंग ग्रेट वर्क देन आई टोल्ड हिम सर इन दैट केस फॉर द लास्ट फोर इयर्स माई ACRs हैव बीन टर्म्ड एज एक्सलेंट एंड आउटस्टैंडिंग बाय माई इमीडिएट सीनियर्स एंड होम सेक्रेटरीज देन वाई डिड यू डाउनग्रेड देम वाई वॉज माई परफॉर्मेंस डाउनग्रेडेड बाई यू I told him that I'd got all the information through RTI. He was stunned. Here is Modi. He said, I don't call up my officers in HS. I said, sir, in that case, you don't have to call up the HS. You knew everything. The file came to you. So basically, I could have become the DG, but you and him did not allow me to. So I ask Rajan Priyadarshi this question. So why isn't there any DG in your state, sir? He said, because Modi has to take revenge against an officer called Kuldeep Sharma. And I've been told that he has his own team of officers. Answer, you know, when I was IGP Rajkot, there were communal riots near Junagadh. I wrote FIRs against some people. The Home Minister called me and said, Rajanji, where are you? I said, sir, I'm at Junagadh. So he said, acha, write down three names and arrest all these three. I said, sir, these three men are sitting with me. And let me tell you, sir, that they're all Muslims. And because of them, normalcy has been restored. And these are the people who have brought the Hindus and Muslims together with their efforts and brought the riots to an end. So he said, dekho, CM sahab ne kaha hai. And then this guy only was CM, Narendra Modi. And he told me that it was the CM's order. I said, sir, I can't do it even if it's the CM's order because these are innocent people. Who was the officer? Question. Who was the officer who was talking to you on the phone? The Home Minister, Gordhan Zarafia. Question. When was this? Around July 2002. So Zarafia said he will himself come. And question. And so who were these people? Answer, are they were good people, Muslim people who were actually helping bring an end to the riots. Anybody else in my place would have arrested them.
So Rajdeep, if I just ask you about this section, as you said, there is an element of hearsay in it. there's an element of direct evidence. But I think maybe overall what is important in this thing is that it matches up with evidence we have from almost every other source. There are different officers who corroborate the same thing in different ways. This brings me to the question, if what we call normal journalism are inquiry commissions, you've seen the officers, you've dealt with these officers, they've spoken supposedly with great sincerity to the press in these commissions, and the truth is something like this. Do we ever have hope of justice in whether it's 2002, it's 84, encounters of actually finding out the truth without means such as this?
You know, one of the things, Artosh, while I was reading this book, was reminded of a man who was, or a judge, Supreme Court judge, who has headed two commissions of inquiry into the two major riots that have taken place in this country. And having a conversation with him in his Luttian's bungalow and wondering if I had stung him that day. I don't know how to use a hidden camera, sadly.
I'll try and teach it.
Because I remember what he said, and it'll always stay in my mind. He said, Rajdeep ji, ye jo Musalman hai na Gujarat ka, ye aisa hi hai. Ye badlega nahi. Jo hua na, aur kuch nahi hone wala tha. I still remember that. I remember there was some sting that took place after that, and I said, shit, I should have also known how to use a hidden camera. The man headed the two biggest riot inquiries in the country. He's still around, and he still continues to avail of government facilities because the commission of inquiry into the Gujarat riots is not over. And he still continues arbitration across the world. He still goes and does arbitration cases across the world while he's doing these commission of inquiry.
We should not take names.
And no, no, it's well, and the irony of it is that he was appointed once by a UPA government or a Congress-led government and once by a BJP-led government. So in a country of hundreds of great judges, I'm sure this country has thrown up wonderful judges, you chose an individual whose prejudice, and this is not me, you can go and ask fellow judges in Gujarat, they'll tell you, whose prejudices were so well known. What does that tell us about the two main parties who have ruled this country for much of the last 67 years and their own moral vacuum, which perhaps, I can see now the Congress party trying to fire off Rana's back because the party itself is so bankrupted. It doesn't have the moral courage for the last 12 years to have actually stayed with the story themselves. And the fact is, and this unfortunately doesn't come out, to some extent it does in the book, that this is not just about BJP. You know, the climate of Gujarat has been vitiated by both parties. There are states today where the Congress and the BJP are in milibhagat. Maharashtra is a state, Madhya Pradesh. The state where the new formula is called 70-30. So, real estate deals, when you're in power, 70% goes to you and 30% to the other side. The same in the case in your dealings with police. And, I think there is a larger mindset issue which also comes through all these stings of the bureaucrats, of the police officers, and obviously their political bosses. And this, as I said, also reflects in the judge concerned, who is a judge from Gujarat. Who is a judge from Gujarat? So, I mean, if someone who headed India's two major commissions believes that, in a sense, minorities need to be taught a lesson, and this judge was appointed by two commissions, and he's come up with pretty appalling reports.
And if I may, and it may be a coincidence that I happen to name somebody who has also served on two commissions, Nanavati, when he was. Nanavati, when he was picked to head the commission in the 84 inquiry, had already passed a judgment, which is why I'll come to Indra Jaisingh, on the butcher of Tirlokpuri, the case of the 84 riots. And he changed that sentence from death, I don't believe in the death sentence, so I will not get, to life by arguing on the compassionate nature of the butcher of Tirlokpuri that he spared the women. This is part of the judgment. He also concluded that the 84 violence was not an organized conspiracy. This was a judgment he set down. Now, seeing this judgment, what does a government pick him to do? will you decide whether 84 was an organized conspiracy or not? Guess what his answer is. Guess what his answer was for 2002. He came to similar answer in both cases. One Congress, one BJP, they were working together. Again, to go back to you, Indrajay Singh, you were saying that the cases will come up before the Supreme Court. Yeah. You have faith. What keeps this faith in you, I mean?
Okay, it's a very difficult question to answer. Let me begin by saying that the prologue to this book is also written by a judge. So that is a partial answer to the question that
I have. Whose report was thrown into the Arabian Sea by the Congress NCP government, who the Shiv Sena refused to even act on his action taken report, who spent 5 of his best years of his life putting out a judgment on the Bombay riots, where more than 1,000 people died and only 9 have been convicted. So sometimes when we target Gujarat, as a number of people do, a Congress NCP government in Maharashtra, more than 1,000 people died, even more than in Gujarat. Yes. Only 9 people have been convicted. To be fair, in Gujarat, because of media and SITs and public pressure, more than 100 have been convicted. So I think we need to, you know, name some of the and shame some of those who have been in power in these states. And Justice Sri Krishna is a classic example of a very good judge whose report was thrown into the Arabian Sea.
And much more of a Hindu than most of the bigots.
That's what we need to point out, because he begins his prologue with something in Sanskrit taken from the scriptures. And yet he was the judge who, as Rajdeep points out, in the 93 riots in Bombay, gave a report, and it's been a kind of a turning point in his life. So I really don't have an answer to your question, what keeps my faith in the justice system going, but I have the faith, and maybe another day I'll meet you and talk to you about that. Maybe it's faith in myself, I don't know what it is. But to come back to come back to 1984 and these two commission reports, etc. Look, the point is, after having seen what happened to 1984 and 2002, one thing is very obvious, that when you have these kind of situations of mass killings, the current legal system is not equipped to deal with it at all. Even the best of judges cannot deal with it. And there are many reasons for this. One of the reasons is, your case is really, it's just a little slice of history. It doesn't take context into consideration. Okay, there's no question of context. It is, as you said, evidence, facts, hard data, and that's it. No one is going to ask you the question, what happened before this event, episodic. They treat cases like episodic events. Okay. You don't see the history and the context of a case when you're giving a judgment. And therefore, the hope, Rajdeep, was that the more appropriate instrument to deal with these issues are commissions of inquiry. And I would say that in this country, we do have one example of such a commission, and that was the Shah Commission of Inquiry, which was set up after the emergency. And to my knowledge, it's the only commission which attempted to do a course correction of structural failures, institutional failures. But of course, we know what happened to that Commission of Inquiry as well, except that, yes, there was a positive fallout in the sense that the NDA government did amend the constitution in a manner that the right to life could never be suspended ever again. This was one, I would say, it was a very important fallout of the emergency. You can call it a fallout of the emergency. But if you want an answer to your question, the answer is quite simply that it all began during the emergency. And it all began in the aftermath of the emergency. It all began with the 1984 riots. And when people ask me, including Teesta Settlewat, she's asked me, and I told her once that she doesn't know why I support her. But I told her, it's not support for you. It is that if we had taken 1984 seriously, 1992 may not have happened, if the legal system was able to deal with it. And if the legal system dealt with 1992, 2002 may not have happened. So really, 2002 was the first time when civil society made an attempt to deal with these issues. And by no means have the issues been resolved.
Rana,
because we have a former Maharashtra chief minister who should answer why that Shri Krishna commission was never acted upon.
I shouldn't have come here. Hello, sir.
Maybe we'll come back to that question when we take up the questions. Rana, in the course of, there's a point that Rajdeep made and Indrajay Singh, And that point is also, apart from the specific incidents, there is a mindset that comes across. Rajdeep told me that he has some of PC Pandey on record, but this man was the commissioner of police during the riots in Ahmedabad. And again, would you mind reading out what you have him on tape saying?
You know, what was most interesting was this one line that most of us, most of the bigots use. No, we are not against all Muslims. I do have a Muslim friend. That one Muslim friend who I dine with. So Mr. PC Pandey says, no, I don't hate all Muslims. Mind you, he was the commissioner of police. He says, you know, humko teen baar mara, ab humko to ek baar marna tha. This is the mentality. This was the mindset that prevailed during 2002 Gujarat. When I asked Justice Shri Krishna to write the foreword for this book, he said, Rana, why are you getting into it? I have been requesting the Maharashtra government, which was ruled by the Congress NCP for 15 years, to take action. So when I read the book, he called me and he said, listen, this is eerily similar to what happened in Maharashtra, this police-politician nexus. Only that the man who did not become the prime minister. I mean, if we can just discard Narasimha Rao for that. Yeah, and Sharad Pawar for that matter. He said, but I'm giving this a last shot at justice. You're a young girl, and I don't want to disappoint you. You all come with these larger-than-life idea of justice, and I have seen it all, so please give it a shot. So I'll read a bit about what PC Pandey told me. PC Pandey was the commissioner of police who really wanted me to meet his son in Surat, who has a diamond factory. And he was the one who made the dinner arrangement of me with Narendra Modi. And when Narendra Modi actually showed me around his bungalow while I wore a camera in my watch, and where Sanjay Bhavsar, his secretary, would tell me, "Iski abhi 10 kitabein aap le jaiye, Modi ji ne khud likhi hain." It's all on camera, so someday, hopefully. Which
one? Somewhere here, I think. This must be the portion of where he starts talking up to you. Muslims, isn't it? Up to my best friend is a Muslim all the time.
I'll read a part of what PC Pandey said. As a question, but the Hindus would have felt so liberated, sir, after the riots. Answer, PC Pandey. Yes, now take a walk in the city and see in the Hindu and Muslim dominated areas. We have to sift through many call records. That's how the IM guys were called. Wow. Question. Answer. And the Supreme Court says don't conduct their cases. Question. Sir, why? Answer. Minority appeasement. That happens in the... question. That happens in the SC too, sir? Yes, it does. These people, Muslims, should be put against the wall and shot dead. You know, one explosion took place, six people die, and then another, and the third takes place at the hospital near the trauma center. And that's where the patients come. So I rang the chief minister and said, don't go, sir. He had reached the commissioner's office by then. The bomb was kept in a van. You see the deviousness of these things? Now you want to appease the Muslims? What for? Votes. My best friend is a Muslim, but that's a different thing. That's just a person. Treat them like everybody. I have no problem. Question. I'm glad, sir, Muslims were taught a lesson during the riots. Answer. Yes, you feel at one point ki jo hua theek hua, which is why I'm so happy that I could get these Muslims behind bars. It was the most satisfying thing. So these Mukul and Teestas of the world say there is anarchy. Yes, there is anarchy, but who created this anarchy? These very Muslims in the state. And not that I have any great love for political parties, but if the Congress is like this, I might as well be with the BJP, Commissioner of Police. Sir, how do you feel about the encounters? See, personally, I'm against encounters. It's like a murder, but at times it becomes very necessary. Question, okay. Answer. That person, Sohrabuddin, was being convicted on charges of holding some AK. There was a recovery and later he was convicted. That was his background. That female Kausarbi was not even his wife. Question. They had an affair? Yeah, she was living in with him. So if you're staying in the company of a man, something that happens to him will also happen to you. You're inviting trouble, no? And it's not that you're not aware of what this man is all about. So now, not that this is the reason for any man to be killed, but then... I can't read any more of this. Sorry, I've gone through this so many times, it's just...
chilling.
Vicious.
So, Rajdeep, one of the things that has happened, and I'll just... maybe just one set of questions and we can throw it up to the audience, is that since these elections, our zeal as the media in terms of pursuing these cases, looking at the process of justice, seems to have fallen drastically. On the other hand, there is a counter narrative being created through George Headley that we in the media are very happy. When I say we, I mean collectively as the media, we are part of the problem that we have to share. What is going on? What are we going to do about it?
Not supposed to ask difficult questions. Look, I think there is a general sense that our political class in particular has that election victories, in a sense, validate your actions, even if those actions are morally questionable. And whether it is Jayalalitha winning in Tamil Nadu as a result her disproportionate asset case, you know, hai chalta rahega. Whether it is the 2014 victory or even 2002 November and 2007, 2012 and 2014, that these election victories in a sense validate what happened. And I think the media is sucked into that. And you know, let's be honest. You know, this is as true again of previous riots as it is of today. And I think the media, in a sense, particularly the so-called mainstream media, finds it difficult then to counter that narrative, because that narrative is so powerful, and it is stated and restated by those in power. And today, those in power believe that, or those in the media believe, one of the critical elements to be in the media is access. How am I going to get access if I start questioning, if I start raising the uncomfortable questions that a book like this raises? And I think that's the problem that the media today is confronted with, that the media itself is very much part of the establishment. And once you're very much part of the establishment and you have to invite someone for your events and everything else that goes on, you're not going to start questioning them with the same vigor that you did. Maybe we were younger, and therefore you, when you're younger, you're crazier and more willing to question. Just one point though on Pandey. Someone on the other side, you know, the whole notion of border or boundary, as they call it in Gujarati towns now. I mean, these invisible borders that you have. And it's said, it's part of your growing up in Gujarat. From the time you're a child to an adulthood, you live in that same little world of yours. So there, it's their world and it's your world. And the worrying part is that while this may have been true of Gujarat, which has a history of riots, it's increasingly true now of larger and larger parts of the country. People live in their own little communities. So there is no intermingling, no understanding of each other. So when PC Pandey says the kind of things he does, or many of these other, whether a Raigad or a Singhal, who interestingly are OBCs, And one of the interesting aspects of the Gujarat riots were that some of the worst rioting was done by Dalits and OBCs. I mean, it was in lower income groups. They were the foot soldiers of the violence, as they were in Uttar Pradesh after Ayodhya, as they were possibly in Mumbai. Mumbai is a little bit more questionable. The Shiv Sena. But certainly it was true of many riots. So, you know, I think it's percolated right down society that this is our society and this is their society. And therefore, when a thing like Godhra happens, it's just the kind of trigger that you need to explode. You know, a number of people over the years in Gujarat have told me, "Arey, hota hai ye. Ye yahan tufan is the word that they use. Tufan hota hai." Now, how do you deal with the idea of people telling you tufan hota hai? And ironically, even neighbors in areas like Shahpur, who live in the same locality, live cheek by jowl. But moment the riot begins, It's time for tufan, because that person is the other. And I think that's the worrying part. And when police officers and senior bureaucrats talk in that language, you wonder what is the social conditioning of our senior bureaucrats and senior government officers.
Which is, so I can understand the media going a certain way. It is not...
Sorry, I drifted away from the media.
It is not something that I like, but I can understand why it's happening. It's easy to point something up. But something else is happening. A government changes and judicial decisions also seem to go a certain way. Is that a coincidence?
Okay, so I can't answer that question, but I can deal with some of the structural issues. And I think you should listen very carefully to what people like Arun Jaitley are saying right now. And you should also listen very carefully to what somebody like Nitin Gadkari said a few days ago. He said, why don't the judges just resign contest elections and come and sit in parliament and run this country. Why are they running the country from the benches of the Supreme Court? Now, you have to kind of, this is the kind of language that is being used by people in the highest echelons of power. And this language is addressed to the judges, okay? Now, also, when Narendra Modi addressed his first speech to all the chief justices of all the high courts, the one thing that he said, he put on the table was that he asked the judges a direct question. He said, tell me, why do you give bail to five-star activists? Now, I found this so horribly shocking that there is supposed to be a wall of separation between the judiciary and the executive. And here you have the Prime Minister of the country standing up and asking a question. Why do you give bail to five-star activists? I was amazed that there was no protest, no spontaneous protest at the meeting itself from the judges, nor was there any write-up in the press until I took it upon myself to write an article. And I said, no, Mr. Prime Minister, you have no business to talk down to the judiciary. So there are lots of complex factors operating here. One is that the judiciary can't speak for itself. And often people like us find ourselves speaking up for the judiciary, even when we sometimes may not want to speak up for the judiciary. But I will say one thing. In the last 2 years, the judiciary as an institution has stood up to the executive on the issue of who has the last word in appointment of judges. Let me tell you very clearly that the game plan here is a very long-term game plan. They want to appoint judges who belong to the RSS and who will be there for the next 20 years. In fact, they are planning that if we go out of power at any point of time, we know that we have planted judges in the judiciary who are going to look after our interests. So, It gives you the answer, actually, to the question. And this is why so people like me, some of us, who ordinarily do not support the current system of appointing of judges, but we found ourselves caught between the devil and the deep sea. Rajdeep knows. He's been telling me for the last 30 years, you hold a red flag to the judiciary all the time. But the point is that, and we've been talking about transparency in the method of appointment of judges, but when we found ourselves, at least I found myself, caught between the devil and the deep sea, I had to make my choices. And I decided that I would oppose the government's proposal, which would have given them the power to appoint judges. And it would be preferable if this power of appointment of judges would be left into the hands of the judges, at least for the time being. Of course, I mean, nothing is ever permanent in the judiciary either. But that one judgment, I think, puts in place an institutional framework within which some of these issues can be raised.
Sure. And Rana, before I sort of ask you to conclude, I'll just mention one thing, because I think we spoke about panelists disappearing. The only person, because he was in the invite, one of our bravest journalists, Manoj Mitta, is not here because of personal tragedy. I think we can extend that to everybody else who didn't make it to the panel. But Manoj has very genuine reasons.
Manoj Mitta is a great reporter. I mean, one of the finest reporters has reported in 2002, and there was bereavement in his family, so
he couldn't make it. So Rana, just to conclude, and then we'll throw the floor open to a few questions. What do you expect to happen now? What would you like to happen now, if you had?
I don't know if my expectations are the last word in this. But I would urge most of us and most of us in the media to just take a step back and introspect about what we've been doing in the last 2 years. Suddenly, most of my journalist friends, and I'll not make a generalization here, seem to have developed amnesia over the fact that Amit Shah was sent behind bars in a fake encounter case on charges of murder. Suddenly, we have developed amnesia that Narendra Modi was once the man who gave these invisible orders to carry out the Gujarat carnage. Now, I believe that, you know, you have every reason to give him a clean chit, and this is justified. But now, when there is this new piece of evidence, and I'll leave that for the investigating agencies to, you know, kind of figure out whether they are genuine or fake, or whether I really did this thing or not, or it's hearsay. All this while, we have been, you know, talking about a clean chit to Narendra Modi by the SIT. I would urge the media to talk about this book and to talk about this new piece of evidence, and should the SIT investigate rather than just ignoring the book and pretending that nothing happened. Believe me, had it not been for social media, this book would not have seen the light of the day, and this discussion and the kind of people who have turned up here. I mean, I was stunned. I thought revelations by the Home Secretary, the Commissioner of Police, the ex-intelligence chief would be relevant enough for our mainstream media, because when we give an entire day to Rajinder Kumar, who is an ex-officer of the intelligence, and we talk about his truth, why shouldn't the other truth also be spoken about in the same manner, with the same passion? This book deserves your attention, a bit of your attention. Just go through this book and try and ask a few questions to your friends in the political dispensation. Ask a few questions to those in power if they would do something about it. A bit about, you know, everybody has been asking me for the last few days, why did I have to go undercover? Why was this book self-published? You know, one of my editors at Tehelka, when I came back and they gave me frivolous reasons for not publishing it, said, you know, you should be thankful that we gave you 8 months salary despite the story not being published. I mean, for heaven's sake, journalists, you know, I was 26 then. I'm a lot more mature now. I was 27, 28 when I came back with my investigation. Journalists are not guinea pigs. So I think either you stop telling them in journalism schools about ethics and you know, about justice and truth, and just tell them, listen, hey, what? When you go out in the mainstream media, just keep justice and ethics aside, because there's no such thing that exists. I mean, I have, at least my experience with justice and ethics in this country has been rather disappointing. Not just with my own organization. I mean, you fight with the dispensation, but how do you fight with your own fraternity? Here, I was putting up a fight against my own fraternity, which was not willing to publish this piece of investigation. I requested, I have approached almost every organization in this country, not to publish it, but at least go through it, go through the videos. But then they said, oh, you know, Sting is not good journalism. Perhaps it's not. But I don't know what to say. I really don't know what to say. I guess in the last 6 years, I've spoken so much about it. I think my therapist will tell you the kind of, every time I sit with him, whenever I have an anxiety attack, I sit with him and I said, I can't sit on this. He said, well, don't talk about it. You've been talking about it for the last 5 years. Do something about it and just let go. I decided to write this book because I could not let it go. I mean, my conscience does not allow it. I mean, I'm speaking from a position of privilege, I think, because most of us have loans to pay. Most of us have family to look after. I really do not. I have a great family which has been my solid support through the last 5 years. And God bless them, and may all of us who go through similar pain, similar agony, similar anxiety, similar depression that I had to face. I stayed in a bungalow with one cobra and one dog for company in a deserted bungalow in Gujarat. And I would sleep till 6 in the morning because I'd want to see the sun, and then go to sleep. I did not get my periods for 6 months because my doctor said I was under tremendous stress. For the last 5 years, I've been taking tranquilizers and sleeping pills to put myself to sleep. But I guess this is the price one has to pay. And all this, just one genuine request, give it a read. And just give it a thought. You know, what is said in this book is not hearsay. I mean, these are officers, highest ranking officers, Maya Kodnani, ex-minister for women's rights and women's child and women care development. So just give it a thought. Santosh.
Thank you, Ron. Rajdeep has to leave, but we'll throw to. Just one thing before we start. Yeah, just 1 minute before we start the questions. Yeah, before he goes. On questions. Sure, just a minute, Sabha. Let me just finish here. I will just throw the questions open, but please, questions, no observations. I'll cut you off. It doesn't matter who it is. Just straight questions, simple to the point. Okay, Sabha. Sure, Sabha, that's great.
I don't see any reason why not. But as I've told Rana in the past, she's got to put a lot of these tapes now in the public domain. These tapes cannot remain in this book alone. They've got to be out in the public.
I've been trying for the last 5 years, trust me.
I know. But now that the book is out,
yes.
You know, sure. The tape, because again, it'll come back to that. Where is the evidence, right? Please understand. Sabha, it's very easy for you to say, I see you on a channel which I'm sure will never happen. You are contracted to that channel. And you are contracted to that channel.
So that...
I can speak for myself, but I think it's unfair to put it on me. Look, it's not about an individual. I think, this is the worst thing. Will you do it? I think this book or any book should... number of readers or viewers, let them decide, and let them decide whether this is hearsay or cocktail conversation. So I will keep what you said in mind.
Now that we know where Times Now and India Today stand, let's just throw this.
Thank you.
So questions, please. Just at the back, yeah. Sure.
Please.
Please.
You have to understand that journalists have to follow certain ethical patterns. This work was done by me for Tehelka. So it was not. It was Tehelka's body of work. Today I am publishing it. I know there could be. I stand a legal case by them. I mean, they could file a case against me for publishing a work which was done for an organization. I have tried to put my.
Please. Yeah. Okay. No, excuse me. Next question.
I'm willing to give the tapes to the SIT even now.
Sure. Next question. So what's the question?
The question is, why do you think these channels, which are trying to be an anti-Times Now in so many ways, aren't being able to take a tougher stand or probe these cases in a much greater way, like you pointed out? I have just been in a year. I'd love to go after my managing editor.
These are the questions that you have to ask the seniors in your office. I mean, I had to leave my organization for this very reason. I mean, at a later stage. I have left 7 jobs in 4 years. For this very reason. So, trust me, I've tried my best.
There's a simple answer. Follow the funding, you'll find the answer. In each case, it's pretty clear what the answer is.
Sainath always says, follow the money. Yes.
Exactly. So, that's true of your channel as well, by the way. Yeah. Okay. Sorry, this side. Sure.
And I want the investigative agency, which is an SIT, which has been a clean sheet already, to approach me. I am willing to give them every piece of evidence, every tape which has been with me for 5 years. Luckily, I got a copy, and because I left the Hellcat at a time, nobody could ask me for a hard copy. I was asked to destroy the tapes and give it to them. I didn't destroy it. I guess better sense prevailed, and I kept a copy of the tape with me. So as soon as the SIT asked me for it, I'm willing to give them the piece of evidence.
Sure, question.
How do you deal with that? And how do you answer that? It's a question I'm wanting advice.
Are you asking me about the Congress?
No, I'm asking you, how do you, like, the Congress story, it was in 1984. Yes, it needs to be dealt with. But in the current situation, how do you answer somebody from the RSS who says that past wrongs have to be righted before you do anything right now? How do you answer
I guess that? You've answered your own question in many ways.
Okay, the questions, Rana, is there an answer you have or should...
For the RSS? I don't know if I have any answer for the RSS, really. I don't know what to say about an organization which has such liberal ideas about about democracy and secularism in this country. I guess, for me, there is no difference between the Congress and the BJP. One wears a veneer of secularism. Other makes it very open and has no pretense about secularism. That's the answer.
Ritu, you have...
What are the independent? Who are the independent publishers?
Olinda, yes,
I really didn't want to name. I really didn't want to go on a naming, but I have approached some 12 publications so far. I must.
Have refused.
Yes.
It's extraordinary because I know that even today, Tulika is publishing.
Somebody just mentioned one of the publications which publishes feminist stuff said, "Oh, this is not our domain. This is riots and sting operation. We do not exactly deal with this."
Yeah. Sure, we'll come. Yeah, next to you, yeah. Yeah.
Prithviraj, you're going to have a tough time today. Here he is.
Would you want to answer the question?
He's just come here as a friend. So,
he's not on the panel, I can't force him to actually. Yeah, please. Question. Yeah.
Why didn't the judiciary stand up? I mean, that was a case of Gopal Subramanian, who was the amicus curiae in the Amit Shah case, and then a different justice who was Amit Shah's lawyer. Why didn't the judiciary stand up when it had the authority to do so?
Well, the answer to your question is that Justice Lodha, who was then the Chief Justice, actually made a statement that he did stand up for him. He said that, now, I cannot verify this statement for you, we'll have to go and ask Justice Lodha. But he did say that he told Gopal Subramaniam to not withdraw his consent to become a judge until he comes back from South Africa to India, which would have been meant a day or two. But Gopal chose to withdraw. I personally believe that the executive would never, ever have agreed to have him appointed as a judge of the Supreme Court for the reason that you mentioned, that he was amicus curiae in the Surabuddin case. Let me tell you that Mr. Ram Jethmalani, who represented Amit Shah, filed an application in court against Justice Aftab Alam because he was a Muslim. It must be said loud and clear. And because he was a Muslim, he said, the judge of the Supreme Court is biased against me. So I can tell you that you're dealing with people who will not stop at anything.
At the back.
अगर कांग्रेस हाईकमान मुझसे ये कहती कि उनको इस बात का अंदाजा नहीं था कि मैंने स्ट्रिंग ऑपरेशन किया है तो मैं उनसे बात करना चाहूंगी. देखिए, मैंने जैसे कुछ देर पहले कहा, कांग्रेस और बीजेपी में मुझे बहुत ज्यादा फर्क नहीं लगता. एक कम्युनल कही जाती है, दूसरा सेक्युलरिज्म का विनियर पहन के घूम रही है. ठीक है, 15 साल से महाराष्ट्र में कांग्रेस एनसीपी की सरकार थी, सेंटर में आप 10 साल तक थे, अमित शाह के खिलाफ केस था, मैं उन सबको पता था कि मेरे पास ये टेप्स हैं, मैं एसआईटी के पास जाने के लिए तैयार थी, लेकिन ये नहीं हुआ. अब इससे ज्यादा एक जर्नलिस्ट जो अपने खिलाफ इतनी सारी केसेस लेके चल रही है, जो अपने ही ऑर्गेनाइजेशन के खिलाफ, अपने ही फ्रेटर्निटी के खिलाफ लेके चल रही है, पब्लिशर्स ढूंढ रही है, जर्नलिस्टिक ऑर्गेनाइजेशन ढूंढ रही है, इसके अलावा मुझसे जो कुछ बन सका मैंने किया. और मुझे नहीं लगता कि कांग्रेस और बीजेपी ये मुझसे कह सकते हैं कि उनको इस बात का अंदाजा नहीं था इतने सालों तक, वो सब जानते थे.
लेकिन मुझे लगता है कि दोनों कंप्लीसिट थे इस क्राइम में, दोनों अपनी अपनी बार्गेनिंग कर रहे थे, दोनों अपने 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 लोगों को बचा रहे थे, तो ये कंप्लीसिटी तो हमेशा होती रही है, आज पहली बार नहीं है। अगर क्या वो नहीं जानते थे, क्या जैसे श्री कृष्णा ने अपनी रिपोर्ट में बाल ठाकरे को इंडाइट नहीं किया था, किया था ऑफिसर्स को इंडाइट किया था, कहाँ है वो ऑफिसर्स आज? कमिश्नर ऑफ पुलिस बनाए गए हैं, बाल ठाकरे को स्टेट फ्यूनरल दिया गया है महाराष्ट्र में, तोपे चलाए, आप हम किस तरह की बात करेंगे? मुझे कांग्रेस और बीजेपी से कोई उम्मीद नहीं है, इसीलिए मैं ना उनके पास गई हूँ, ना मेरे पास उनके पास जाने का कोई शौक है। एज अ जर्नलिस्ट मैंने अपना काम किया है, अब इसके बाद इन्वेस्टिगेटिव एजेंसीज का ये फर्ज बनता है जो वो इन केसेस को इन्वेस्टिगेट करनी है, कि वो मुझसे आके पूछे कि भैया तुम्हारे पास क्या एविडेंस है जिसके बेसिस पे तुम ये किताबें लिख रही हो, तो मैं शायद उनसे कुछ बात कर सकूँ।
Logic and reality. I can give you 100 it's going to get you. You know, I mean, where is it going to get us? This whole book is about the subversion of justice. And the difference. There's a difference between subversion of justice by the private individuals and subversion of justice by the state. And this book is about subversion of justice by the state. And when the state subverts justice, there is very little you can do through the judicial route. But the good news is that there is a paper trail for every single thing that's happened in the 2002 riots and all the encounters. For that matter, there's a paper trail about what happened in 1984. And so long as that paper trail exists, and so long as this book is in the public domain, and so long as the videos are going to be put online, I can tell you that the law can still catch up with those who are responsible.
Last two questions.
You would refer to yourself as the lone soldier on the field of the book when you're talking about how you conducted this thing. And more recently, there's been a case of a reporter from DNA who conducted this thing and the organization didn't support her. So even when you're reporting on stories such as this, even before your organization made it, they were not going to publish this story. How much help did you get from them when you were reporting and reading things that they were?
Well, I got my salary according to them. That's a big deal, right? I got my salary, but how I arranged my accommodation, how I got a fake PAN card, how I operated as a fugitive was of no importance to them, as long as they would send me emails saying, oh, excellent, great work. Oh, why don't you just go to a spa and help yourself? That was the last of, yeah. So I'm sorry, that's...
I mean, do you think that dissensitivizes reporting like this?
Well, it happens across the board. And any reporter you meet, they might want to tell you in off-record conversations. They can't afford to lose their job.
Ram, if I may just ask a straight question. You said the editors, I assume that's Tarun and Shoma at Tehelka, told you that, no, I think we need to name names across the board. Yes. If they asked you that there is political pressure, this is 2010, it's a Congress government for the next 4 years. What is the pressure you...
I wouldn't know. I was told there are loose-ends in the story. One of my editors, as I said that these are coffee table conversations. I read out some bits to you. Does it look like coffee table conversation to you?
Sure.
I don't know. I mean, I don't have any answer to that.
Last question, Joe.
Hi. Lovely. I've been reading this and listening to you, so I'm absolutely thrilled that you put this out. Christina Rocha had given a good certificate to the Gujarat government in the US Congress. She said, she was asked what is going on by the senators and the congressmen, and she said that the legal system in Gujarat and in India is very robust. So after this, are you going to address some of these issues? Because Mr. Modi is going to address the Congress there. And would you be interested?
If any news media organization helps me with a platform, I'd be most happy to do that.
Now I think we'll close the questions here. Thank you, Rana.
Thank you all. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you.